Welcome, this is Information Service Engineering, Lecture Number 9, Knowledge Graphs, Part 4. This now is the last section on the Web Ontology language OWL. So far, we have learned how to define classes and complex classes. This time, we also want to focus on properties. Okay, let's begin. What we can do, like in RDFS, also in OWL, we can define property hierarchies. And for that, of course, we simply adapt the already existing RDFS subproperty of. So if you want to define one property to be a subproperty, which means a specialization of another more general property, you are using RDFS subproperty of, as we already know it. However, OWL enables you also to define properties which are the opposite of other properties. So for this, you're using the keyword OWL inverse of. So this defines an inverse property, which connects not A to B, but B to A. Of course, it's another property then. And of course, you also can state that two properties might be identical. And for this, you have OWL equivalent property. Let's have a look at the following simple examples. So we have, for example, the property is made of, and this is an object property in OWL, and we define this as being a subproperty of consists of. Not everything which consists of something is also made of this. However, then you see this is kind of a specialization generalization relation we have here. Okay, let's have a look at inverse relations. We define reads as an object property, and the inverse of would be then is read by. So I can say a person reads a book. The inverse property would then be is read by. I can just say then a book is read by a person. And if I want to say that two properties are identical, for example, I can define here composed of as an object property, and I can say an equivalent property of composed of could be consists of. I can define it that way. It doesn't have to be that way. Of course, this is only a kind of definition which states that these two OWL object properties then are identical. Okay, what else can I do? I can define more complex property relationships by putting constraints and additional qualities on these properties. For example, we can define that a specific property should be transitive. We are doing this by using the OWL property OWL transitive property, which means then I can define, for example, if A is a part of B and B is a part of C, via transitivity rule, it would hold then that also A is a part of C. We can define symmetric properties via OWL symmetric property, which would mean I could define is neighbor of as a property, as a symmetric property, and if A is neighbor of B, then it would also hold that B is neighbor of A. Functional properties, for example, has mother AB, which means A has the mother B. And if I then also have the assumption that A has the mother C, since it's functional, this means this one can only be connected to a specific, to one specific other object or entity on the other side, then it would hold that B equals C. So otherwise it wouldn't be functional. And of course it works also the other way around. Inverse functional property, which means then here that the subject must be the same or can only be one. And here you simply take the inverse property of has mother, then you would use has mother of. If B has the mother A, if B is mother of A, and C is mother of A, then it would hold that B equals C. Otherwise, it wouldn't be inverse functional. So here, this holds functional property for the subject part, and this functional property here means functional for the object part. Okay, we have here functional and inverse functional properties that we can define. How are they now used in OWL syntax? Let's have a look of an example. First of the transitive property, and it works in the same way for all of these properties if you want to define them. So therefore we only have here a transitive property example. So Here our example is we define the object property is published before as being a transitive property. So we say it's an object property and it's a transitive property. And of course, as you see here, transitive properties only make sense if you define this here for object properties. Domain and range here thereby is books. And we say Animal Farm is a book. It has been published before 1984. And Brave New World is a book. It has been published before Animal Farm. Thereby, by rules of transitivity, and since this is a transitive property, we can then also entail the following fact that Brave New World is published before 1984. That comes in handy because you can use exactly these kind of property qualities to create new implicit and explicit knowledge. What else is possible? Since we have symmetric properties, we also can define asymmetric properties. Like for example, if I define A is left of B, then of course it's not possible that B is also left of A. So this doesn't hold. You can define reflexive property, which means if I say X is related with X, then of course this means is related to always refers some individual to itself. So it's reflexive. It can also be irreflexive, so that it's not possible to refer to the same individual. An irreflexive property here with our irreflexive property. And you would simply then say, for example, X is parent of Y. Then, of course, X cannot be equal or identical to Y because X is the parent of Y. So, which means this is the father or the mother. Okay, so I can, besides transitive, symmetric, and functional, I also can define asymmetric, reflexive, and irreflexive properties. And Owl, and it works exactly the same way like we did this with a transitive property example. Okay. Moreover, I can also state that two properties are disjunctive. This is the case if two individuals, X and Y, are never related via both properties, then they are disjunctive. Like for example, I can say has sibling, which is an object property, and this is disjoint with, so the keyword I'm using here is property disjoint with has child. So has sibling, of course, then if X and Y are related via has sibling, which means X is the sibling of Y, then X cannot be the child of Y. This would be some strange kind of family business. However, there are shortcuts, which for example mean if you want to define a list of disjunctive properties and not, you know, define this disjunctiveness condition between all potential pairings, then you simply write it in the following way. You define here a blank node of RDF type all disjoint properties. So this is new, which is a class, and this class has the following members, and then you have a list. Again, this is not extensible, so therefore here in parentheses, and you put in there has sibling, has child, and has grandchild, and you say all of these three properties, they should be disjoint, so disjunctive properties. Two new keywords, owl, all disjoint properties as a class, and owl members as the members of exactly this class that you here exactly count or enumerate. Okay. We have it almost. One more thing, for example, would be interesting. You can also state that two individuals are not connected or are not to be connected via a specific property. And these are so-called negated property instantiations. So two individuals can explicitly be defined as not being related with each other via a given property. For example, I can say that George Orwell is not the brother of Aldous Huxley. Authors, you should have heard about them, and I do it the following way. Again, I define a blank node here, and this is of type negative property assertion, class here that I define, new keyword, and a negative class assertion of course must have a source, an assertion property, and a target individual, which means the negative class assertion refers to the source individual George Orwell. On the assertion property is brother, so this doesn't hold. for the target individual, which is Aldous Huxley. You see lots of new keywords here, negative property assertion for a class description. And then you have here three new properties, source individual, assertion property, and target individual. With that, you simply then annotate here George Orwell, his brother, and Aldous Huxley. These are negative or negated property instantiations. One more thing I want to tell you about properties. These are so-called property chains or property chaining. This is quite interesting. A simple case of property chaining is transitivity. And for example, I can, via a transitive property, define simple facts like the friends of my friends are also my friends. So this means that the friends relation is transitive. So has friends I can define as an owl transitive property. However, if I want to state the fact that the foes of my friends are also my foes, so here I have a friend, this friend has a foe, and it should be created in the way that, yep, exactly, this is also my foe. I can't do this simply via a simple transitive property. I need these two different properties, and I want to create a new property which consists of these two properties. So far it doesn't work. I could do this, for example, with first order logic. Then I would say, okay, for all individuals x, y, z, where x has the friend y and y has the foe z, it holds that x has the foe z. Okay. And now to come up with something similar like that in also description logic, one introduced the so-called general role inclusion or property chaining possibility. And with that, I can define a new property, like for example, has friends foe as an owl object property. And I define this being connected or being constructed from a so-called or via a property chain axiom. So I have to connect this property has friends foe with property chain axiom, and then I simply state the properties which have to be chained with each other to form exactly this kind of new property. And here I have has friend and has foe. So here the sequence also is important, and of course you can't extend it afterwards. Again, we have a closed list here with parentheses, and then I define exactly this thing, has friend, has foe. This defines then has friends foe. Of course, I could then also continue the chain further on. The point, of course, is this is only allowed for object properties, for data type properties. This kind of modeling doesn't make sense. Okay, we have one thing missing. You remember in the last section of the lecture when we had these cardinality restrictions on properties for class definitions, I was giving you the example with a string quartet. And in the string quartet, we restricted the number of members to 4. However, we did not restrict to the class string instruments or string players. We simply did a cardinality restriction, and now a qualified cardinality restriction or qualified number restriction is a restriction which holds for both a number, cardinality, as well as, you know, a specific class in the range. So if I want to do a qualified number restriction, for example, I can say, what is a successful author? A successful author might be an author who has more than one bestsellers among his notable works. I could write it in the following way. I can write here a successful author, and I say this is a subclass of something of which I do a restriction on the property notable work. And the first thing I say, okay, I give a minimum qualified cardinality, which is a lower bound, and I put this to 1, and I put it on a specific class, and this is then on the class bestseller. So 2 new keywords, min qualified cardinality and on class. And of course, besides here writing one class or also giving here then again a nested complex class definition, what I can do is also, besides here this lower bound, I can also use upper bounds like max qualified cardinality or give specific bound like qualified cardinality. And now you can also think of how to better express, for example, and formulate what is a string quartet. But I leave this, of course, to you. Okay, we almost have it. Only a few subtleties to add for OWL. We can, for example, also define classes by relating individuals to themselves. Like, for example, if I want to say a philosopher is somebody who knows himself, I would define it in the following way, that I define philosopher again as a property restriction. So on the property knows, and there I can use a new keyword, which is OWL has self true, which means somebody who knows himself is in the class philosopher. Okay, small addendum. However, I also want to show you what are the limits of OWL. So what is not possible to formulate with the help of OWL? The point is, if we go beyond OWL, then often then more expressivity means more complexity. And this might lead to undecidability like first order logic. So therefore, certain things have specifically excluded from OWL so that OWL still is computationally manageable. The question is, do we really need more expressivity than OWLDL offers? I have an example for you where you can see that. If we want to define what a squanderer is, we can define a squanderer as a person whose expenses are higher than his income. How to define this in the end based on description logics? Of course, we can say a squanderer is a person. We can also say a squanderer has expenses and a squanderer has income. But then related, especially, you know, on individuals whose expenses are higher than their income. That is quite difficult. We have here to combine classes and properties in the definition by mixing also A-box and T-box information. And this would not hold. This is not possible in OWL. The only way I can do this, for example, would be via first order logic. And there I could say, yeah, what is a squanderer? So if X is a person and X has income Y and X has expenses Z, and if Z is greater than Y, then it holds that X is a squanderer. And this kind of arithmetics, of course, which is not part of first order logic, I could model with the help of a predicate. So Z greater than Y, I would simply model as a property between Z and Y, which is true if Z is greater than Y. So this would be exactly the formalization of what is a squanderer in first order logic, but this is of course then based on first order logic and it's therefore undecidable. Okay, but this should give only you a brief glance or a brief insight on the complexity of OWL and the expressivity of OWL. So what is possible with OWL? And of course, there are things which are not possible, so that go beyond OWL. So we have to know the limits exactly for what we want to model here and how to do that in the end. And there are, of course, then extensions of OWL in terms of rules and stuff like that. But this is not anymore part of this lecture. With that, we have said anything what we can say to you now in this lecture about OWL. Of course, in self-study, just look at the references, just look at the other knowledge graph videos that might be available in the OpenHPI course if you are interested in further description logics or in further knowledge about OWL and creating ontologies with OWL. So this was it, more or less, with OWL. What are we going to do in the next part of the lecture? In the next part of the lecture, we are going to apply our knowledge on RDF, on Sparkle and everything else. And we want to do a little bit of knowledge graph programming.